Well, guys, tonight we are in the book of Job. I want to invite you to be there with us. Job chapter 40. Make your way there. Join us as we continue just our verse-by-verse, chapter-by-chapter study within this book, and hoping now that even tonight that God would meet you there. Hope you have a Bible already and you're making your way there. If you do not, hey, grab one. There's one around you in a chair nearby. We want to invite you here really with the intention that God would meet you tonight through his word, that he would show you things that he's wanting to speak to you, and we believe he's that faithful and long for him just to do that. So let's take a moment as we do each week and each study, and we've opened up our Bibles, we've made our way to a passage, but in a very similar way, it really is needed that we'd open up our hearts right now. And maybe that's already present, and maybe you're here and you're ready to hear from God, but we just want to give you a moment. I'm going to lead you in prayer and just invite you just to make sure that you're ready to just hear from him, that you'd ask for his strength, his touch, his guidance, and his work right now to bring you into everything that he has. So let's ask him for that. Father, right now we ask, Lord, you see our hearts right now where they are and the position in that sense that they're in. God, would you work right now just to bring us to a place of just hearing your voice, granting us favor, giving us strength, giving us ears to hear you. Lord, just opening up our hearts that you would give us understanding. Open up our understanding to your word and your truth, and in a way that just makes it meaningful in this moment, effective going forward. Lord, just that we would grab just all that you have for us this evening. We ask for that as we just trust you as a God who is faithful, asking for your work even right now. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Well, guys, we move into this evening, and I think about where we are, and in many ways, I want to invite you to meet, if I could say it this way, the biblical world of dinosaurs. I want to invite you into a place that's really going to be at least some of what our subject matter is. Now, I want to be very clear, because I'm using the word meet as clearly and as effectively as I can. I just want to humbly, and I hope it's humbly, and both honestly tell you, I'm not an expert. I don't have any, pretense that I am. I don't want to stand up here saying that I know everything about this, and there's no way we're going to accomplish all of it tonight. There's so much more, and, for some of you, it's going to be enough, but others, it's going to be enough to make you want to know more. I'm going to tell you, there are ministries that have made their focus about this. We support creation ministries of church. We have Answers in Genesis that we work with and use their curriculum. Both incredible ministries. There are a lot of people that are incredible resources. Think about Russ, who's here tonight, one of the guys who considers just passionate about creation would be a great resource. I just want to tell you that there's much more than we're going to get into this evening. But I'm hoping to bring you to it and just to help you to see it. To see it before it, and we want to see that. Because in our passage tonight, we're going to meet two incredible animals. We're in chapter 40. We're going to pick it up where we left off last week. And in verses 15 to 24, we're going to meet this animal. It's called the behemoth, and just see who he is. And then we're going to go into chapter 41, and we're going to meet the Leviathan. And God's going to lay out these two incredible animals to us, and really in many ways seeing what they are. So I tell you what, let's do this. Let's quickly make our way through the passage just because I want you to have seen it. If you haven't already, I just want to read them with you. We'll talk just a little bit about them. And then we'll come back and kind of begin to talk about what this means. Like, what do we do with this? And why is this here? And how do we process some of what's before us? And so we'll attempt to tackle that after we make our way through it. But just want to invite you with me to join. Let's just read through the section in chapter 40. And then we'll come back and just piece by piece point out a couple of things. Pick it up there in verse 15. God is speaking to Job and to us. And he invites us. He says, Look now at the behemoth, which I have made along with you. He eats grass like an ox. See now his strength is in his hips and the power of his stomach muscles. He moves his tail like a cedar, and the sinews of his thighs are tightly knit. His bones are like beams of bronze, and his ribs like bars of iron. He is the first of the ways of God. Only he who has made him can bring near his sword. Surely the mountains yield food for him. All the beasts of the field play there. He lies under the lotus trees and in covert of reeds and marsh. The lotus trees cover him with their shade, and their willows by the brook surround him. Indeed, the river may rage, yet he is not disturbed. He is confident. Though the Jordan rushes into his mouth, though he takes it into his eyes, or with one pierces his nose with a snare. Well, we meet this animal, this behemoth, and I want to just point out to you a few of the things. And again, you can go into more detail if you're interested, but we know that it's a herbivore. I mean, we know it eats grass. It tells us there in verse 15, look, I've made him to eat grass. He eats grass like an ox. And his strength is really found in his hips, it tells us in verse 16. The power of his stomach muscles. I mean, God tells him in a way that Job would have been able to see this, not, you know, looking, you know, later as you kind of dissect the thing, but I mean, one sense visible in many ways, the way that you would look on it. And then perhaps one of the fascinating verses in verse 17, or at least effective in helping us understand what this is in verse 17. It says, he moves his tail like a cedar, and the sinews of his thighs are tightly knit. It's as if he tells us that his tail is like this incredible, it's a cedar tree, this huge tree that in many ways there, and especially up in Lebanon and where that would be, they would grab it. And without spending much time on this, I want to tell you, this is one of the ones, I mean, all of it really flows together, but, you know, really gives, you know, just locks down that we're not talking about, you know, maybe an animal that we would know today. I mean, we think about a tail, and you got to picture a tail like a cedar, you know, some huge, you know, kind of thing there. And I just want to tell you, and I want to say so in a very gracious way, not mocking way. I mean, some people will say, well, you know, maybe we're talking about, you know, an elephant. You know, maybe, you know, as we talk about this, the power of it, of its things. But I just can tell you, if you know an elephant doesn't have a tail like that. I mean, elephant's got this little tiny little waggly thing. It's definitely not a thing that moves like a cedar. Or some would say, well, no, maybe it's not an elephant. You know, maybe it's a hippopotamus. Now, again, if you know your kind of animal history and know about that, I mean, hippopotamuses are fearful animals. I mean, quite honestly, they are. But once again, I mean, not much of a tail. Look, a little weak, you know. I mean, no, you know, you wouldn't look at that and go, man, that's moving like a cedar, man. Just look at that. It's like, that's not how you would describe that thing at all. So certainly one of the things that we begin to discover is that this is most likely being described as a dinosaur, that it would just be describing what that would look like, one of the large dinosaurs that would be in the midst of that. In fact, he goes on to describe him a little bit more. It says there in verse 18, his bones are like beams of bronze. I mean, just strong, huge kind of idea. And he tells us that as he looks on this, he says in verse 19, he is the first of the ways of God. Only he who has made him can bring near his sword. Has the idea of be strong and first. Hey, don't read in this word first like an element of time. I mean, every now and then people will go, is this talking about evolution? Is it saying like they came first? No, that's not it at all. We'll talk more about that in a moment. But this word first has the idea of chief, strongest. You know, one of the biggest, one of the largest would have the idea. It's like he is so big, so massive, you know, that if you were to take a sword to him, it'd never work. Says only God could do that. I mean, in one sense, because he's just that massive. He's just first. He's chief. He's highest. He's biggest of the things of God. Verse 23, going down there, says, indeed, the river may rage, and yet he's not disturbed. And kind of goes on to say he could take the Jordan into his mouth. I mean, it says in one sense, the Jordan, a rushing river there in Israel, is like, no big deal. Can just, I mean, just allow that. I mean, just in one sense, giving us a picture of a very large animal. Again, I just want to put before you that I believe, and I will again just be honest, not everybody sees it this way. Good Bible students who love God, care about his word, would see it differently, and I wouldn't, you know, want to, you know, say they're wrong altogether. I see it differently. This seems very clear to me that this is talking about a dinosaur. I mean, it would find itself in the category for you guys who maybe know dinosaurs in the sauropods. I mean, some of the largest of the dinosaurs that we know of. I mean, you think about just kind of considering the different ones that would be there. Maybe Apatosaurus, you know, kind of you're looking over at the bottom right down there. I mean, the African elephant right now is the largest land animal today. Got to see a man right there next to him. And that would be kind of the scale. I mean, it's the idea of this massive animal. I mean, this massive one, and maybe this as a different, you know, scale chart would kind of show it, you know, maybe its length, its tail like a cedar. I mean, just, you know, huge, you know, in the midst of it. That's really what God is describing. He's describing this animal that's just, its bones are like bronze, you know, who can just lay down in the water and take the, you know, the river into its eye, who, you know, you took a sword to it and it'd be like, that's not going to work. You know, this thing's huge. I mean, how would you even come close to it, God says. In fact, I think about the description, again, just different kind of just verse on the screen. You know, God says, just look at this behemoth, which I made along with you. That's a key verse, which we'll come back to. He eats grass like an ox, and his strength in his hips, the power in his stomach muscles, his tail like a cedar. I mean, he is, in that sense, just chief. I mean, one of the largest of the animals that God made. I mean, that's why he's bringing it before Job, just helping him to kind of consider who this is. And it's a fascinating description that has more depth in those verses than I went into, but enough to kind of give you an understanding. Okay, yeah, that's what we're talking about. Well, we think about that one, and then we want to transition to chapter 41, and we meet another one. God has introduced him now to the behemoth, and he now switches. It says in verse 40, chapter 41, verse 1, can you draw out the Leviathan with a hook? And again, I just want to do what we just did a moment ago. I'm just going to read through. In fact, I think I'll read through about half of it. We'll pause, point out a couple of things, and I'll read through the other half. But I want you just to kind of feel it. You know, and just the way it's supposed to come across, just impact as you consider what Job's being just told here by God. It says, can you draw out the Leviathan with a hook? I mean, can you go fishing and catch this kind of thing? Or snare his tongue with a line which you lower? Can you put a reed through his nose or pierce his jaw with a hook? Will he make many supplications to you? Will he speak softly to you? Will he make a covenant with you? Will you take him as a servant forever? Will you play with him as a bird, or will you leash him for your maidens? Will your companions make a banquet of him? Will you apportion him among the merchants? Can you fill his skin with harpoons or his head with fishing spears? Lay your hand on him. Remember the battle. Never do it again. I don't know why. I just love that. I love the way it's like, you know, just easy, like, lay your hand on him, remember the battle, and you'll never do it again. You'll be like, never, that one time is all it takes. Is any, indeed, any hope of overcoming him is false. Shall one not be overwhelmed at the sight of him? No one is so fierce that he would dare stir him up. Who then is able to stand against me, God says? Who has preceded me that I would pay him? Everything under heaven is mine. That's the point that we need to come back to. But again, you catch some of the descriptions, right? I mean, God just lays out this animal as untamable. He says, you know, would you catch him fishing? I mean, it's never going to happen. You know, you're not going to do that. Or would you pierce his nose with a hook? Would you speak softly or somehow make him a pet? You know, it's like, no, you'll never do that. I mean, he's not one that is that. In the first six verses, he just tells us there's no way. I mean, this animal is untamable. And in verse 7 and verse 9, it talks about him in many ways being unconquerable. It's like, you know, he says, you would look on him, and you could take all the harpoons that you could muster. You could fill his skin with harpoons, would do no good. You could tie in, you know, fishing hooks and harpoons in the midst of that. He says, again, you'd lay your hand on him, and you would remember that battle, and you would never do it again. Because he's telling us, again, this animal here is so powerful, so mighty, so strong, that in that sense, again, it's unconquerable. Well, let me keep reading. Go down to verse 12. God says, I will not conceal his limbs, his mighty power, or his graceful proportions. Who can remove his outer coat? Who can approach him with a double bridle? Who can open the doors of his face and with his terrible teeth all around? His rows of scales are his pride, shut up tightly as with a seal. One is so near another that no air can come between them. They are joined to one another. They stick together and cannot be parted. His sneezings flash forth light. His eyes are like eyelids of the morning. Out of his mouth go burning lights. Sparks of fire shoot out. Smoke goes out of his nostrils. And from a boiling pot, and burning rushes. His breath kindles coals, and a flame goes out of his mouth. Strength dwells in his neck, and sorrow dances before him. The folds of his flesh are joined together. They are firm on him and cannot be moved. His heart is as hard as a stone. even as hard as the lower millstone. When he raises himself up, the mighty are afraid. Because of the crashings, they are beside themselves. Though the sword reaches him, it cannot avail, nor does the spear, dart, or javelin. He regards iron as straw, and bronze as rotten wood. The arrow cannot make him flee. Sling stones become stubble to him. Darts are regarded as straw. He laughs at the threats of javelins. His undersides are like sharp potsherds. He spreads out pointed marks in the mire. He makes the deep boil like a pot and makes the sea like a pot of ointment. He leaves in a shimmering wake behind him. One would think that the deep had white hair. Or on earth there is nothing like him, which is made without fear. Indeed, behold every high thing. He beholds every high thing, and he is king over all the children of pride. I mean, again, amazing descriptions. You're kind of walking through this, and again, he's just telling us this thing is incredibly powerful. He says, you know, in verse 12, he says, you can't conceal the mighty power of his limbs, his proportions. You know, you couldn't approach him. He says, you wouldn't, you know, bridle him like you would a horse. It's never going to happen. I mean, he just says, never going to happen. He's got, in a sense, these terrible teeth. He says, all around. I mean, these massive, terrible teeth that find themselves just absolutely fearful. Tells us about his just impenetrable scales. It says, you look on him, in verse 12, it says, his rows of scale or his pride, they're so tightly, you know, knit as with a seal. One is so near one another that no air can come between. And it's a pretty, I mean, it's like this incredible, you know, scaly hide that just nothing can get through. In fact, it goes on to describe him, you know, even more later in verse 12 and 23, it says, the folds of his flesh are joined together and they are firm on him and cannot be moved. I mean, this is just kind of a massive, impenetrable, I mean, the kind of thing that could just turn anything away. And then you probably caught it. I mean, he lets us know that not only is this, you know, kind of a fearful being, kind of a fearful animal that God made. Yeah, it's actually kind of a fire-breathing animal. Like, in case you didn't kind of catch that, yeah. I mean, it's like a dragon, I mean, kind of, right? I mean, that's kind of the idea. I mean, some of you, you're like stuck in the Lord of the Rings, and you kind of got smog kind of put there before you. Doesn't say anything about him flying. But, I mean, he does lay that kind of a picture for us. And one of the fascinating things about this is that so much of mythology and history, you know, sometimes finds itself in reality, that this is really kind of a fire-breathing mammal. I mean, you kind of read through that, and again, just notice what it says. It tells us in the midst of that, you know, there in verse 18, his sneezings flash forth light. I mean, he just sneezes, and it's as if light comes out. His eyes are like the eyelids of the morning. Out of his mouth go burning lights. I mean, just, you know, sparks shoot of fire shoot out of his mouth. I mean, kind of a fire-breathing animal. Out of the mouth go burning lights, and fire shoot out. Smoke goes out of his nostrils, and from a boiling pot and burning rushes. His breath kindles coals, and flame goes out of his mouth. I mean, this is crazy, kind of like, yeah, this is, you know, there. I mean, and he's describing this, again, as a way that this is what Job would see in the midst of all this. Tells us in the midst of all this, you know, here's this incredible, scary kind of monster, and he's just fearfully strong. I mean, just fearfully strong. I mean, just strength dwells in his necks. He says, you know, sorrow dances before him. I mean, he just has the idea that, you know, if you were ever to think about attacking him, he says, you know, though a sword could reach him, it would never avail. Verse 26, nor does spear or dart or javelin. He regards iron as straw. Like, you know, you kind of big, you know, whatever they would be, you know, pieces of iron, doesn't mean anything. Bronze, just like rotten wood. Arrows can't make him flee. Verse 28, sling stones. You know, these large, you know, throwing stones at him just don't really mean anything to him. Just, they're stubble to him. Darts are regarded as straw. He laughs at the threat of javelins because his underside is like sharp potsherds, and he spreads pointed marks out in the mire, and even as it goes into the water, and obviously an animal that goes under the water in the midst of this, he says when he does so, he leaves this wake. It's like you would think like something just happened. You would look at this and watch this thing dive into the water in verse 32, and it says he leaves a shimmering wake behind him. You would think that the deep had white hair. I mean, you can almost imagine it, can't you? Can't you just see the picture? It's like dives in. It's like, wow, that's kind of crazy. I mean, just in this crazy moment, he says, in the earth, there's nothing like him, which is made without fear. He is, in this sense, again, kind of this king of pride. Just in this one, he says, you know, of all the animals, that there's nothing that he's afraid of. He's just powerful. He's mighty. He's strong, fire-breathing. In that sense, altogether fearsome. Now again, we look at this and trying to figure this out. Well, it does find some Bible students in different places, but probably we're talking about a theropod or one of those in that category. Again, just at least a supplication in the midst of it, which would be in the category, by the way, that a Tyrannosaurus Rex would be in. I mean, kind of that kind of T-Rex kind of mentality in the sense of that. Perhaps one like that in the midst of it, and again, working through that. Yet others have seen it differently. I mean, others kind of wonder if this is more dragon-like and even maybe more of an aquatic, you know, animal. And so some who would, you know, draw pictures of how they see it would see something that's much more dragon-like looking in the midst of it, that would be much more like that, or much more just it would handle water in the sense of everything that would be there. And again, it's kind of a guess, but it's still certain that he's talking about something that's incredibly powerful. Incredibly fearful. And I mean, it's these amazing descriptions. I mean, for some of you, you're like, you really like these verses and you're like, I love reading through them. Others are like, I didn't even know that was there. I never even thought about it. You know, I mean, never in my mind did I actually think about, you know, I thought a fire-breathing, you know, animal was just, you know, all fiction, which it's not. We actually have animals that can do that on a much smaller scale even now. But I mean, we look now at this, it's a crazy thing that in many ways that God describes, well, this incredible dinosaur in many ways. So we process that, and as I lay that out and just read through it with you so that you can kind of understand, yeah, we're talking about two incredible animals that we would classify as dinosaurs, a behemoth and a leviathan. What do we do with that? I mean, how is this supposed to work through? Well, let me try to answer a couple of questions. And again, I'm sure I'm not going to answer them all. Great resources online, great people you can ask or pursue this on your own. But maybe we just need to begin with this one. Like, so how does it actually work? I mean, how do dinosaurs fit into the timeline? How do they fit into the Bible? I mean, how does that whole thing work? And again, your approach to this is probably different around this room. I just want to understand this, but some of you are like, how come it doesn't say dinosaur? I looked up in a concordance and it doesn't even have the word dinosaur in the Bible. And quite honestly, it's kind of simple that in one sense, that the word dinosaur wasn't really even invented until 1841. I mean, it wasn't even kind of came out as a term that in many ways, long after the King James, and you know, it just didn't really find its way in there. And then from that point to this point, been a lot of debate about it. But from my perspective, and it's at this point I want to be very gracious again, but just tell you kind of where I am unapologetically what is known as a young earth creationist. And again, I want to say that I'm unapologetically, I believe this with all my heart, and I kind of want to lay that out to you and reasons why, you know, that what that would mean by being a young earth creationist means that I believe that the world is roughly around 6,000 years old. That about 6,000 years ago, give or take, some in the midst of that, because there is some debate there, but roughly there, everything began. Everything began, that God spoke and created everything. I don't believe in millions or billions of years. I don't. I really think everything goes back that, you know, only about 6,000 years. Now, I want to just say this again carefully. That's not a saving issue. Meaning again this, if you're here tonight and you're like, Jim, I don't know, you're kind of like bonkers here. I mean, I don't know if I really agree with you. You know, you kind of think you're off on a tangent. You know, if I see that differently, am I going to lose my salvation, you know, kind of thing? No. I mean, again, very good, very godly people disagree on this. That doesn't mean I think it's a small issue. I don't think it's a small issue. I mean, I just think godly people can be wrong. You know, but it's just not a saving issue. What you believe about dinosaurs doesn't determine, you know, whether you're going to heaven or not. What's what you know about Jesus that determines that. So again, some very good godly people would see this differently, but I see it this way, and I could give you a lot of reasons, but I'll give you just a couple. First of all, I mean, it's just biblical. I mean, that's what the Bible says. The Bible speaks of God creating heavens and the earth in 6 days. You read through Genesis and you read it that way. In fact, he says it in other places, just to use another verse. There in Exodus, he describes it. He says, for in 6 days, the Lord made the heavens and the earth and the sea and all that is in them, and he rested on the seventh. It's really part of the Ten Commandments, kind of God explaining why. But I just want to tell you, God just says it. He says, that's what I did. I created it in 6 days. Now, if that's like an impossibility to you, I'm just going to say it in the most gentle and kind way I can. Then your God is too small. If you don't think God could create everything in 6 days, then you don't know the God of the Bible that I know. I mean, I just how he describes it, and the Bible says it that way. God says it that clearly that he created it that way. Now, that's important, and again, that's just taking the Bible literally, and that's not an unimportant issue. I mean, if you begin taking things not literally, where do you stop? I mean, that's a huge issue. But I want to give you the thing that locked this down in my own life. I mean, I didn't come at this way at the beginning. I didn't grow up as a Christian, and when I first got saved, I didn't even see this as a big deal, and I kind of thought, you know, who cares? You know, people argue about these things. I really didn't, but as I began studying and pursuing it, there was a lot of weight going back and forth, and I began reading and doing some research, but there was one issue that just, I mean, knocked it out of the park for me. It's like, okay, that's it. I mean, this seals the deal. There's just no doubt about this in my mind whatsoever. And that really is a theological issue, that it really is an understanding of the truth of the Bible, because, see, the Bible tells us that death entered this world through sin, that what caused things to die, people to die, and animals to die, was sin. That would make it impossible to have millions or billions of years of life, death, and sickness before the fall of mankind. Because it didn't happen that way. I mean, I think about how it says it this way in Romans 5, where it simply, you know, kind of lays it out to us, tells us, therefore, just as through one man sin entered the world, and death through sin. So death was not a part of creation. Death was not a part of what God originally made. Adam and Eve sinned, and when that sin entered, sin marred this creation, and death became a part of reality. That it wasn't a part of reality before that. And thus, death spread to all men. I mean, that death now became a part of life. It became a part of every person. But not just every person. Creation itself was locked into that curse. Romans 8 goes on to describe it this way. It says, for creation was subjected to futility. That all of the animal kingdom, that everything around us, it became locked into this cycle of emptiness and futility of what sin had produced, not willingly, but because of him who subjected it in hope. Because the creation itself will also be delivered from the bondage of corruption into the glorious liberty of the children of God. See, here's this amazing thing that's happening. We sang about it tonight, you know, this endless hallelujah, this time that we're going to be with God, and there's going to be no more tears, and there's going to be no more suffering, and that's what the Bible says is true. It's going to be true for us, but all creation as well. Creation's suffering right now because of sin. Now, if you believe in evolution, then there's a little bit of a problem here. Because somehow you would have to assume that millions or billions of years of dead things is good. That that's what God wanted. And if that's what God wants before Adam and Eve, then what's to say it's not going to be that way after? I mean, if that's good, if death and suffering and pain that animals even endure is normal and that's okay and that's good, then I don't know what kind of heaven you're looking forward to. Because you wouldn't be able to say that's all going to be different. No, see, here's the thing. We're looking at a creation that's suffering because of our sin. Hey, can I bring this way, way down? Maybe it's happened even recently to you, or you had someone that had a beloved pet that dies. It's always a heart-wrenching thing when, you know, we think about that and just the joy that God's given us in animals. And I don't know how you process that, but I know what I'm able to say. You know, that's because of sin. I mean, animals are suffering right now because of sin. The reason animals die is because of Adam and Eve's sin. And I know that that's going away, not just for me, but for all animals. I mean, there's not going to be any more death or sickness in any part of creation because that all began with Adam and Eve's sin. And there's just no doubt about it. That's roughly about 6,000 years ago. I mean, even the, you know, evolutionists, however they do it, the farthest back they usually will take mankind is about 10,000 years. You know, they'll think that maybe man kind of evolved 10,000 years ago. Nobody believes that we had any longer history than that. And I'm just telling you, no, see, nothing died before that. Nothing. Nothing ever died before Adam and Eve sinned. When Adam and Eve sinned, that entered into the world, and God's going to take it away so that now he can tell us that last enemy that will be destroyed is death. Death is going to be destroyed, and never will anything or anybody ever die again because sin brought in death. I just want to tell you, I mean, when my mind wrapped its way around this, it was like, duh. I mean, there's no other choice. I mean, it can't be true. It cannot biblically be true that you're going to have millions and billions of years of dying and that being a part of God's good plan. I just want to tell you, it's just hundreds of things go into that, but I'm just going to tell you again, I don't know if it makes anybody's, you know, sense, but I'm just remembering the very first time I saw this, and it's like, I don't know if I ever got that before, but I got it, and it's like, okay, I get it. I mean, that just locks it for me. I mean, it absolutely locks it that it must be that way. Now, as I think about that, I just want to tell you this, because some of you are raising objections and questions, and I just want to tell you most evolutionary claims, in fact, I'd say all of them, well, most at least in this sense, can be answered in the flood. Most of the things that people use as proof of millions and billions of years actually don't work. Fossils, it's because of the flood. I mean, really it is. I mean, you look out at things that are happening around the world. I mean, all of it is. And I want to tell you, there's some incredible work that's been done on this. Some of you, I mean, I think about when Gary Bates was here and, you know, he talked about even, you know, Mount St. Helens erupting and just all that happened after that. I mean, just the incredible things that, you know, from a mini Grand Canyon that was created, like 1/40th the scale. In just, you know, in a very short period of time, there were petrified wood that was created. There was, you know, upright, you know, just logs that kind of went into the, I mean, incredible things. I mean, everything that people kind of look, well, like this had to be because billions of years. Like, no, actually it didn't. I mean, actually that's probably a worldwide flood that changed everything. I mean, just changed everything. And again, if you want more on that, that's not really the subject matter here in Job 40:41. I just want to tell you it's this. I think about answers in Genesis, and I love, you know, one of the graphics they used in this. They kind of said, you know, the reality is that we know these things. We know there's fossils. We know there's dinosaurs. I mean, that's not, we know there were. It's just really what lens you're using to look at it. And you have a whole lot of secular theories and man's theories that look at it that come up with millions and billions of years. We're using the Bible. Now, I'm saying that unapologetically. Again, this, I mean, it's like, so I want to look back and think, okay, how did this work? How did dinosaurs, I'm using the Bible. Does that kind of preconceive things? Yeah, it does. I mean, I'm not going to argue. I mean, we're both taking the same facts and we're coming to different conclusions, but it's because of the worldviews we have that we come to those conclusions. And it's just what, I mean, the facts remain. They're there. It's just how you interpret them. And for us, it's to take the Bible and say, okay, so what does that mean? I mean, that means that we think about what this looks like. And so for me, again, I'm unapologetically just a young earth creationist, which means biblically, there was never a time that dinosaurs existed and man did not. There was never a day on planet Earth where there were dinosaurs and men didn't exist somewhere. Now, maybe in the beginning it was, you know, more sparse when Adam and Eve, you know, they got to start somewhere in the world. Yeah, they're probably not all the way there, but there was never, you know, they were created on the same day. So dinosaurs and people lived at the same time biblically. Never, whether ever a year or a day or a week, that they weren't, because they were created on the same day. So again, I'm just telling you from my perspective, I believe in dinosaurs. I really, really do. I just believe in them biblically, that they existed as we exist. So that raises up other quick questions. And so let's try to process that Okay, so if Bible tells us that, I mean, we get to read about some dinosaurs, crazy cool. If they fit into the Bible, and if dinosaurs only existed during the time that we exist, then what happened to them? I mean, how come, where are all the dinosaurs? Well, let me just tell you a couple of things. First of all, they did not die in Noah's flood, in the worldwide flood. Now, honestly, most of our fossils probably came from the flood for a lot of incredible reasons that really kind of creates fossils. A lot of the fossils we have, and even dinosaur bones and stuff, probably happened from the flood, but they didn't die in the worldwide flood. I mean, I think about people who do little cartoons, kind of imagining, we missed the boat, kind of thing. No, but no, it actually tells us that every animal came to Noah, and there wasn't any that God created that wasn't on Noah's ark, which means dinosaurs were on the ark. Didn't mean they had to be full-grown dinosaurs, but they were there. And so they're there. And in fact, on top of that, understand this. We think about where we are, and what we're working through. Job is a post-flood book. When we talked about this in our very first week in the book of Job, I mean, we tried to lock down a timeline to Job, and it's a little bit debated, but he's probably on one side or the other side of Abraham. So that's less than 4,000 years ago. Probably in the 3,700 years ago. I mean, that's pretty incredible. Kind of, in other words, just that short period of time ago, Job, who had this book written to, he gets described these animals, but God says, hey, go out and look at them. I mean, he's not describing history. He's describing to Job things that Job actively saw. So, I mean, it's a crazy thing. Yeah, we know that. And again, there's a lot of archaeological evidence about that. In fact, there's lots of, things that have been, found in these kind of deals. But again, biblically, that's kind of what we're looking at. It's not that long ago. In fact, we could even say it this way. Some of it, there are probably some that kind of fit into that category of dinosaur even today, and some fascinating research on it. But when we think about this, understand this. I mean, obviously, we're looking at it, and we think, well, what happened to them? I mean, the most of them here. Well, I do want to tell you this. The dinosaurs didn't die in the flood, but the world radically changed in the flood. I don't want to even begin to kind of go down some of that speculation, but I just want to tell you a lot of things happened. About 2,000 years into human history was Noah's flood. So again, roughly 4,000 years ago, give or take, not arguing, just specifics in there, but just as a rough, kind of place in there. Before Noah's flood, people lived a long time. I mean, they lived 600, 700, 800 years. I mean, just common. I mean, you read through the early parts of Genesis and it's like 900 years, it's just a crazy thing. As soon as the flood is over, all the lifespans drop to just a little over 100, to just a couple generations later, Moses is able to write, and he's able to say, 60, 70 years, that's kind of the normal lifespan for people. I mean, he drops way, way down. So something happens that makes life less robust for us, probably for the animals as well. And it begins to kind of produce that, in one sense, just a flow downwards that I want to just say it simply this way. Most dinosaurs have gone extinct. I mean, most of them have. Now, extinction is a fascinating study, and again, some of you are smarter and you'll go into this or know it more, but on average, some scientists estimate that we're losing animals by the rate of 8 to 10 a year. I mean, extinction's happening. Again, some would go far bigger than that, but it really kind of goes into their views of evolution and stuff like that. But I just want to tell you what maybe you already know. Animals are going extinct now. We have species that are dying out now. It's happening in radical ways, and it's always been doing it this way from this whole time. So can I just tell you again, from a biblical perspective, our world is not evolving. We're not getting better and better and better and better. It's not this survival of the fittest where, we're actually going the other direction. We're devolving. We're on a steady course that from creation, from the flood, we're on a downward road. Now, again, I think about this, and we have this whole huge debate about global warming, and I'm not even going there because that's a really political subject. I just think a lot of it's a lot of goofy, and there is a lot of weird kind of facts in it. But I'll just tell you this. There is no doubt that our world is dying. There's no doubt about it. There's no doubt about it, and it's not because you use plastic bags at the grocery store. I mean, I'm not saying that we're not harming the environment. I'm just telling you, we are on an unstoppable course to an end, that everything's winding down. Everything from the sun to the, you know, size of the deserts to, I mean, just no doubt about it that we're on this road that you'd look and think, something's radically happening. Animals are dying off more and more and more. We have less and less, and we're on a road that's been that way. And so most of the dinosaurs, probably from the flood, you know, creation itself took a turn where life became less robust. And more began to die. And so most of them have died. I mean, that's just kind of what's happened. But that's happening all the time. It's not like something we can't observe. No, it's happening. So that's not a problem for us. I mean, it's not like we're thinking, you know, what happened to dinosaurs? Like, they died. You know, they went extinct like so many things are happening. And probably their size alone probably made some of that less and less possible for them to even exist in our world as it was moving. Well, okay, let's ask one more question. So we're kind of thinking this way. We meet some dinosaurs in the Bible. We know at least biblically where they fit. They fit alongside mankind. There's no other place biblically, I think. We know that in this sense they've gone extinct, but why do you need to know this? Why does God tell this to us here? Why use up chapter and a half of the book of Job to introduce us to the behemoth and the leviathan? Well, I think you already know, but let me just say it. God's doing this to help Job and help you and I see how big God is. That's the point of the chapters. I mean, you got that, right? I mean, in fact, we read it. You might just go back to chapter 41, verse 10. God's described the Leviathan. We just read it there in verse 8. It says, "Lay your hand on him, remember the battle, never do it again." Told you I like that verse. "Indeed, any hope of overcoming him is false. Shall one not be overwhelmed at the sight of him? No one is so fierce that he would dare stir him." Then God asks the question. So if you can't even deal with my creation, one of the greatest, you know, most fiercest of the animals that I made, God asks, you know, "Who then is able to stand against me? Who has preceded me," God said, "that I should pay him? Everything under heaven is mine." God's allowing and using just these animals to help Job see how big God is. I mean, that's the point of it. In fact, let me take you back to where we were last week and the week before. God's answering. It's my favorite part in the book of Job, chapter 38 to 41. Job's asking questions about suffering. Why am I suffering? What's happening? And God begins an answer that's entirely different than we might have thought. It began with just a very gentle rebuke where God just, you know, told Job, you know, "You have a lot of things to say for someone that really doesn't know very much," in a sense what he said. And then for a chapter and a half, God unveiled creation. He said, "Tell you what, let's just talk about my creation. Let's talk about the clouds. Let's talk about the stars. Let's talk about some of the animals. Let's talk about, you know, how they all work, from the lions to the eagles." I mean, just he talked about his creation for a chapter and a half, that God's telling Job through his creation alone that he could see how big God is. And then he pressed in harder, and we talked about this last week when, you know, God tells, you know, Job, "Would you condemn God that you could be justified?" I mean, Job, you're basically, you know, because you can't figure life out, you're thinking I'm wrong. You know, you're putting the blame on me, and really was a finger that God put into the wound in Job's life and helped to kind of show that what was there. And then when he's done with that, again for another chapter and a half, God unveils the wonder of his creation, from the behemoth and leviathan. And what I want you to see is, you know, God is dealing with Job, and there's definitely some moments of conviction, but the weight of what you have before you, I mean, the most of what God says is to talk about his creation. And he just says, you know, "Look at what I've done. Look at the animal kingdom. Look at what's there." In fact, I tend to think in kind of weird ways, but you could even just do it, you know, by the numbers. You know, there's 16 verses in these few chapters that really is God correcting Job, saying, "Job, you know, a lot of words. He doesn't know very much. And then, you know, you're condemning me." But there's 114 verses that God says, "Look at my creation. Walk outside and look at what I've done." And what I'm trying to tell you is something I've said for a couple of weeks, and I wish I could figure out a better way to say it. But I want to tell you this, what God does for Job here not only is fascinating and wonderful, it's accessible. God writes a prescription for Job's struggles. that you can fill. That he says, you know what? You know what you're looking for right now? I can tell you where to go find it. Just walk outside. Just walk outside. Why don't you look at the stars? Watch the clouds for a little while. Look at my creation. You know, you're wrestling with, you know, hard questions, theological questions, but God just says, here's what you need. You just need to go outside and you need to think about my creation. You need to think about what's there. That's what God is doing. And even in these chapters, that's the point. God helps us and helps Job see his bigness and how that all works and what that is. And I want to tell you, I think for you and me, that should be part of the point of this chapter and a half. I'm just telling you, and I hope I haven't been cruel or unkind, but I really believe one of the reasons these verses exist, this chapter and a half in the Bible, is because God knew what you would be facing. He knew that you would be being pounded by a lie that I believe is a lie that would rob you in 100 ways. Because evolution, not only do I think it's wrong, and again, I'm not being mean if you see it differently, but I believe it of hearing God's voice. Because in so many ways, what God longs for is he's telling us that we could see his bigness in dinosaurs and all of creation, but what evolution tells you is you walk outside and just go, isn't that amazing just how that kind of just happened all by itself? And that just kind of just, you know, evolved all by itself, and it cuts off a voice that God wants you to have. See, I don't know, maybe it's different for your life, but I'm just telling you, dinosaurs are real. Really were these incredible animals. You guys know it. You've seen shows, I'm certain. Most of you have gone to a museum. And you've seen some replications of dinosaur bones. And you've stood there, you know, as you've maybe stood next to some, you know, incredible, you know, just facsimile of what they think it might have been like. And you've done that. And maybe you've seen the different animals that are there. And you've walked through that. But I'm just honestly asking. See, I'm wondering if you're hearing what God was saying through that. See, I just know this. You can go there and you can see these bones, and there'll be the signs that talk about millions of years, and there might even be a guide and an audio recording going telling you about how amazing these were billions and billions of years ago. But I'm just telling you, if that's what you're listening to, you might have missed something. See, I think you can go to a natural history museum and tune out what they're saying and stand next to those bones and go, my God made that. This is big. This is a big God. That's what he is. And I feel small. I think that's what I'm supposed to feel. I mean, could that not even be part of the reason that God has preserved some of the dinosaur bones for us? I mean, so that we could go, even though we don't get to go and see these animals, I mean, that you could go next to them and you could hear what God is speaking to Job. God, you're amazing. God, you're amazing. Look at that. I mean, we're big. And who do I think I am? I'm so small. I'm so small. I mean, I could stand next to something so large and effectively make me feel small. I want to tell you, I think that's what God wants us to hear. Add to that a certainty that this world is going away. I mean, we are rapidly going away. You'd stand next to dinosaur bones and you'd think, I wonder what it would have been like to be like Job. I wonder what it would have been like to go out and just watch some fire-breathing, you know, dinosaur and then think, I can't because our world is dying. We're losing things all the time. We're on a road, and I need to make sure my heart is fixed in eternity, that I could do like Abraham and Jacob of old and say, you know, my heart is not here. I'm looking for a new city. I'm looking for a new world where righteousness dwells, because I don't want a world where death and sorrow and suffering are everything that people know. I want to tell you, there's voices that are speaking to you that I just don't know if we're listening to. But I think they're meant to be there. I think they're meant to be there. I think about what Paul says in Romans, where he says, you know, since the creation of the world, his invisible attributes are clearly seen, being understood by the things that are made, even his eternal power and Godhead, so they were without excuse. He says, here's what we have. We have God speaking through his creation so that we can see through the things that are made how powerful God is, and the lie of evolution makes you not hear that. And then make you look and think, God made that. My God made that. That's my God that did that, and feel the weight of that. I think about what it says in Psalms, where it says, the heavens declare the glory of God. The firmament shows his handiworks. Day unto day at other speech. Night unto night it reveals knowledge. I mean, we've talked about this for a few weeks, but I'm just telling you, there are voices to be heard. in God's creation every day, every day. And if you don't believe it, then you're not listening. And I just want to tell you the point of this chapter, I think, and part of it, is to help us see that. So that we'd look at it and go, you know what, I get it. At least I think we should. They are that. So tell you what, I'm going to put one more screen graphic up on the screen. This will be the one that actually is the one we have at the end of the service. But I was just thinking about it, and I thought, you know, this is really what I think God wants us to look. That we'd say, look at the behemoth, this dinosaur, which God made along with us. And we'd see that, and we say, God's a big God, and little me. That's what I get. That's kind of what I'm getting out of this is God's big, and that's what he's telling Job. Job, do you really think you're that big? Do you really think you can question me and, you know, bring me to account and accuse me of all these things? You can't. And instead of God unpacking huge theological yarns and great truths that God could, he just says, you know what, all you have to do is look at my creation. And you go, what in the world was I thinking? I can't even deal with his creation. I mean, God is bigger than I am. He is so much bigger than me. And I hope you believe that. I hope even tonight, just walking beside Job, seeing these two animals, that it's met you. Well, that's where we're going to end. You can close your Bibles. We'll pick it up next time. And just long that God meets us in the midst of it. Again, I want to just say, you know, if you still walk out of here tonight and you're like, Jim, I don't know if I agree with you. I know people, I have friends that are like, you know, maybe God did it through evolution. And I know what they're saying. And if you leave here this place, I'm not going to argue with you. I don't think you're, you know, lost and going to hell because you believe that. I think it's wrong because it misses some of the basic theological arguments. But my greater concern is I just want you to hear it. I just want you to hear what God is saying. Because God is prescribing something into Job's life that is accessible by you. It's accessible by you. You could take his first call and think, you know, I'm having a hard time. I don't understand my life. I'm struggling with questions. And you just go out and watch the stars or you watch the clouds. Or maybe that doesn't work. You think, I'm going to go to a museum. That's what I'm going to do. I'm going to go stand next to some dinosaur bones. That's what I just need to do. I'm just going to go and I'm going to tune out everything else and I'm just going to think about my God and what he has done. And I wonder if God is writing a prescription that we just need to fill more often. And say, that's what I need. I need his creation to speak into my life such incredible truths about who he is. And I'll walk away from him saying, God, you're big. And I'm not. And I'm so glad you're big. So with that in mind, let's close in prayer. God, I think about just what I'm trying to say. And I just recognize where I'm saying it from. I am so small. Small in the midst of this world and your creation of a little voice. Lord, you are so big, you're vast, your knowledge, your comprehension, your power, revealed in your creation everywhere. God, we covered a lot of truth tonight, and you understand even where it is. And Lord, some are just fully on the same page, and this just was encouragements to them. Others find themselves confused, just thinking, I don't know where I am in that. And I just pray in the midst of that confusion, you would meet. But in the end of the day, at the end of the place, I pray for everyone here just to be aware that you're God and you're big and you're all-knowing, all-powerful, all-wise, present everywhere. You're God. It is what we need. I just pray that you'd help us to get it, that you'd help us to hear that and process it and take it in further than we've yet gone. Lord, this prescription that you write for Job, fill it in our lives. Just ask for that right now. In Jesus' name.
How great. How great is our God. Sing with me, how great is our God, and all will see how great is our God. The splendor of the King, clothed in majesty, Let all the earth rejoice. All the earth rejoice. He wraps himself in light, and darkness tries to hide, and trembles at his voice, and trembles at his voice. How great is our God? Sing with me, how great is our God, and all will see how great is our God. And age to age he stands, and time is in his hands. Beginning and the end, beginning and the end. The Godhead, three in one. Father, Spirit, Son, the Lion and the Lamb, the Lion and the Lamb. How great is our God? Sing with me, how great is our God, and all will see how great is our God. Name above all names. Name above all names, and worthy of all praise. My heart will sing how great is our God. Name above all names, and worthy of all praise. My heart will sing how great is our God. How great is our God? Sing with me, how great is our God, and all will see how great is our God. How great is our God? Sing with me, how great is our God, and all will see how great is our God.
Let's all stand together for this last one. You stood.
You stood before creation, eternity in your hand. You spoke the earth into motion, my soul now to stand. You stood before my failure and carried the cross for my shame. My sin weighed upon your shoulders, my soul now to stand. So what can I say? And what can I do? this heart, oh God, completely to you.
So I'll walk.
So I'll walk upon salvation, your spirit alive in me, my life to declare your promise, my soul now to stand. So what can I say? What can I do but offer this heart, oh God, completely to you? So what can I say? And what can I do but offer this heart, oh God, completely to you?
So I'll stand.
So I'll stand with arms high and heart abandoned in awe of the one who gave it all. I'll stand, my soul, Lord, to you surrendered. All I am is yours. So I'll stand with arms high and heart abandoned in awe of the one who gave it all. I'll stand, my soul, Lord, to you surrendered. All I am is yours. So I'll stand with arms high and heart abandoned in awe of the one who gave it all. I'll stand, my soul, Lord, to you surrendered. All I am is yours.
So I'll stand. Last time.
So I'll stand with arms high and heart abandoned in awe of the one who gave it all. I'll stand, my soul, Lord, to you surrendered. All I am is yours. All I am is yours. All I am is yours.
Oh Lord, we do stand in awe of you tonight, just considering the vastness of who you are. That you're transcendent, Lord, that you are filling the entire universe right now as we speak. Everywhere at the same time, Lord. We consider ourselves to that, and Lord, we would have to say, Lord, we are so small. So, Lord, I pray that we would respond to you rightly and that we would lay down our lives and surrender. And, Lord, that we would offer you, all of us, Lord. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. God bless you.